Rip Van Winkle by Washington Irving. Let's start here with this problem. How do you get readers not used to reading fiction to read fiction? In the early 1800s in America, readers were far more accustomed to reading nonfiction and poetry, particularly religious or confessional poetry, than they were to reading the genre of fiction. Well, one way is to trick readers, to explain that what they are about to read is not fiction at all, but some other type of writing. By the time Rip Van Winkle was published, deceptions like this had been going on for a while overseas. Daniel Defoe, in his book Robinson Crusoe, suggests the text was adapted from Robinson Crusoe's journal. But the most famous example comes from Samuel Richardson, who wrote Pamela as a series of letters, an epistolary novel, in such a way as to convince readers that the book was anything but fiction, rather a collection of actual letters that was being published for the reader's moral edification. Much of the early fiction published in Europe was based, at least in terms of their plot, on mythology and the Bible. Richardson broke with these traditions in a number of ways. His novel presents the story of a young girl from a poor family who needs to support herself at a young age. It's presented as a series of letters, mostly from Pamela to her family and friends back home, about the struggle she finds after her first employer dies, and after which she works for a wealthy gentleman named Mr. B. That's the letter B, which is another trick to ask readers to believe that the man's name was removed to protect his actual identity. Unlike other early fiction in England, the details in these letters are realistic and precisely convey the life of a young girl. Here is an excerpt from that first letter. "Dear Father and Mother, I have great trouble and some comfort to acquaint you with. The trouble is that my good lady died of the illness I mentioned to you and left us all much grieved for the loss of her, for she was a dear good lady and kind to all us, her servants." The effect of these elements together, the form of the letters, the first-person voice, and the specific details, was to suggest that the book of Pamela was personal history rather than invented fiction, and that people reading these letters were witnessing the real-life struggles of an actual girl whose private life was revealed in her own voice. The story largely focuses on how Pamela attempts to maintain her virtue, even though the lecherous Mr. B is always after her, giving her gifts and trying to seduce her. And did readers believe the artifice? Generally, yes. There's one famous story in a town where the book was read aloud. Once the reader arrived after weeks at the point where Pamela convinced Mr. B to do the honorable thing, the listening audience got the church keys and rang the parish bells in commemoration of Pamela's commitment to her virtue. In Rip Van Winkle, you can hear echoes of this old strategy, places where, perhaps playfully, the author, Washington Irving, is suggesting that this story is not actually fiction, but a type of cultural history of the stories that the early Dutch settlers brought with them to New York. This is from Rip Van Winkle. The following tale was found among the papers of the late Dietrich Knickerbocker, an old gentleman of New York, who was very curious in the Dutch history of the province and the manners of the descendants from its primitive settlers. His historical researches, however, did not lie so much among books as among men, for the former are lamentably scanty on his favorite topics, whereas he found the old burghers, and still more their wives, rich in that legendary lore so invaluable to true history. Whenever, therefore, he happened upon a genuine Dutch family snugly shut up in its low-roofed farmhouse under a spreading sycamore, he looked upon it as a little clasp volume of black leather, and studied it with the zeal of a bookworm. So what this fictitious author, Dietrich Knickerbocker, sees here in these old houses are the means to create a book of his own, something that might be described as a social history. This isn't fiction, per se, but an account of the early stories and legends that the early Dutch settlers in New York, those burghers and their wives, told when the region was only a colony. There's a number of elements in this introduction that I like. Washington Irving, who had money and who had been to England, understood that his own writing was not nearly as sophisticated as fiction being produced overseas. It seems that, in ways, he's accounting for that here. by explaining that the abilities of his alter ego, that Dietrich Knickerbocker, aren't as strong as they could be. You can see Irving apologizing for the abilities of Knickerbocker in the section that follows. The result of these researches was a history of the province during the reign of the Dutch governors, which he published some years since. There have been various opinions as to the literary character of his work, and to tell the truth, it's not a whit better than it should be. Its chief merit is its scrupulous accuracy, which indeed was a little questioned on its first appearance, but has since been completely established and is now admitted into all historical collections as a book of unquestionable authority. Washington Irving had used his alter ego of Knickerbocker previously. In fact, he's had a great time with this artifice. A decade before Rip Van Winkle, in 1809, after he completed his first significant book, a comedy of sorts called A History of New York from the Beginning of the World to the End of the Dutch Dynasty by Dietrich Knickerbocker, he put together a marketing campaign that relied at times on a hoax. He placed advertisements in New York papers, in which an innkeeper sought information on this Dietrich Knickerbocker who had skipped out on his hotel bill. At the center of this hoax was a fictional threat. The fictitious innkeeper announced that if the fictitious Knickerbocker didn't pay up his hotel bill, he would publish this unusual manuscript left behind and keep all of the profits from the book for himself. This, of course, was designed to provoke interest in the manuscript that Irving had written under the name of Knickerbocker. Here, however, in this story, Washington Irving seems to be covering his tracks a little bit more, playfully attempting to discourage anyone from looking for this Knickerbocker. Again, from the introduction. The old gentleman died shortly after the publication of his work, and now that he's dead and gone, it cannot do much harm to his memory to say that his time might have been better employed in weightier labors. As for that next barrier, how did Washington Irving attempt to interest readers in American fiction when Americans were still more interested in Europe? His answer is going to be a common one for the first few decades of the 1800s. In terms of nationality, this fiction has a type of hybrid nationality. It has something European and something American. You will find different combinations of this strategy in other stories, but here, this is a European story placed in an American setting. Washington Irving even goes out of his way to tell us that. This, again, is from the story towards its end. The foregoing tale, one would suspect, had been suggested to Mr. Knickerbocker by a little German superstition about the Emperor Frederick de Rothbart and the Kyffhäuser Mountain. Rip Van Winkle, from this angle, is based on a German folktale that Washington Irving likely learned about during his time in Europe. In adapting it for an American audience, he is attempting to create an American literature by drawing on traditional European tales and placing them in the States. The specific folktale he refers to is Peter Claus, which is set in a German village. The story of Peter Claus follows a German goat herder. While searching for some missing goats, Claus journeys into the forest to a place where people are playing games. After drinking a little of their wine, he falls asleep just like Rip Van Winkle and doesn't wake for two decades. But the big question here for literature is, what does the story offer its original audience? The three key elements of contemporary fiction as we know them now are depth of character, originality of plot, and specificity of place. But these really aren't found anywhere in the story. The plot is wholly lifted from Germany. The character of Rip is wildly underdeveloped. For example, why did he marry the dame if he so dislikes her? And the setting has no cinematic depth. So what, then, does this story offer? In terms of structure and narrative goals, if we went down to the local bookstore today, I don't think we could find any story written in the last year with a similar structure to that of Rip Van Winkle. Rip Van Winkle takes its cues from nonfiction, particularly the type of argumentative political tract that would have been familiar to readers in the early 1800s. The center point of Rip Van Winkle is that he sleeps through an important part of American history. Perhaps you noticed this while reading. He falls asleep while New York is a British colony, and he wakes up after the Revolution, when New York is part of a new country called the United States of America. It's a story of comparisons before and after the Revolutionary War. Behind this is a popular opinion about the cost of the American Revolution. In Irving's time, Americans were generally led to believe that the Revolution was entirely beneficial to Americans, and its effects after the war were without significant social cost. This story wants to interrogate that assumption. In this story, we as readers are going to walk up the mountain with Rip before the war, fall asleep, and then return 20 years later as though it were the next day. The story then asks us as readers, is it true that America is a better country after the war and that independence and freedom are being maintained with no significant social cost? In other words, this story places in sharp relief American culture before the war and American culture after the war so that we as readers can make strong comparisons of our own. To see how this story works, let's take a look at the sections before the war and then the sections after the war. So what is Rip like before the war, and more importantly, what is America like before the war? Well, Rip plays with children. He shrugs off extra work, shrugs off some family responsibility. He's a perpetual child, and as in the case of many later American stories, is looking for some place where he might continue as an adolescent. He is liked by everyone, everyone except, of course, his wife, the dame. He is not entirely delinquent in his responsibilities. His family has food and a small house. His children have basic clothes. He keeps some crops and livestock. But his wife, Dame Van Winkle, would like to improve their standard of living, perhaps with a more productive farm that would create additional surplus to sell, perhaps with a larger and nicer house. But Rip would rather spend his free time with his friends down at the inn, having a drink, reading an old newspaper, or talking with travelers. Rip's priorities, I think, mostly are as follows: to provide the basics, but nothing more than the basics for his family, and then focus on his friends and neighbors, which is where he finds meaning in his life. Social events for him are prioritized over non-necessary work opportunities. This is just another version of that social American character like Tom Sawyer or Jake Barnes in The Sun Also Rises. Or to put this in contemporary terms, Rip Van Winkle is pretty much the Seth Rogen of his day. The story hinges on the day that Rip goes up into the woods. Why does Rip go into the mountains? Well, primarily, the complaints of his wife for him to be more productive, more responsible, to grow up. He'd much rather go down to the inn and have a drink with his friends. But if he goes hunting, he can have a pleasurable time and justify it because he is providing meat for a family meal. And besides, if he were to go down to the inn and have a drink, the dame would probably come down there and yell at him in front of his friends. For readers familiar with romantic literature, they probably sense that this is the turning point of the story. This is the moment where Rip leaves the city behind and ventures alone into the woods, into nature, which is often where the interesting things happen. He spends time there hunting with his dog Wolf, and just as he's about to go home, he hears someone calling his name, a voice he doesn't recognize, although it's clear that this voice knows him, first name and last. Let me read that section of the story. As he was about to descend, he heard a voice from a distance hallooing, "Rip Van Winkle! Rip Van Winkle!" He looked around but could see nothing but a crow winging its solitary flight across the mountain. He thought his fancy must have deceived him and turned again to descend when he heard the same cry ring through the still evening air. "Rip Van Winkle! Rip Van Winkle!" At the same time, Wolf bristled up his back and, giving a low growl, sulked to his master's side, looking fearfully down into the glen. Let me pause here for a moment. This is the invitation to adventure, into what we don't yet know, but the person or spirit or being here is aware of Rip Van Winkle by name and by temperament. We know that the person is real, not just a hallucination, because of the dog's response. If this were a movie, just like any horror movie in which people move out into the woods, the camera angle in this scene would shift when the spooky effects begin from the person down to the dog. If the dog reacts, we know the unusual situation is real. And to continue, Rip now felt a vague apprehension stealing over him. He looked anxiously in the same direction and perceived a strange figure slowly toiling up the rocks and bending under the weight of something he carried on his back. He was surprised to see any human being in this lonely and unfrequented place, but supposing it to be one of the neighborhood in need of his assistance, he hastened down to yield it. On nearer approach, he was still more surprised by the singularity of the stranger's appearance. He was a short, square-built old fellow with thick, bushy hair and a grizzled beard. His dress was of the antique Dutch fashion, a cloth jerkin strapped around the waist, several pairs of breeches, the outer one of ample volume, decorated with rows of buttons down the sides and bunches at the knees. And here, let me pause again. Rip knows what he's looking at, and the original readers did too, but maybe we don't. The figure in how he's dressed looks like a person from old Flemish paintings, something that Rip would have seen in town, someone whose style of dress is about 100 years out of date, which would make the withered man extremely old. This is how the first Dutch settlers of the region dressed. The man is a ghost or a spirit, or at least he has lived for an unusually long time. And then Rip notices one more detail about him. He bore on his shoulder a stout keg that seemed full of liquor and made signs for Rip to approach and assist with the load. And how does Rip process this detail? Well, he must think, I couldn't go to the pub today because of the dame. But look, the pub has come to me. And from there, he hastens down to help the old man with the heavy load, thinking likely he'll be able to get some of its contents. Once on top of the mountain, the unusual being is joined by other similar beings, and Rip observes that these men have unique powers. They are like the Roman or Greek gods in that they have the ability to control the natural world. At this point, Rip knows that he's dealing with some type of supernatural beings, and that the liquor that they are drinking is some type of strong drink, an ambrosia for the gods, as described in the following passage. What seemed particularly odd to Rip was that though these folks were evidently amusing themselves, yet they maintained the gravest faces, the most mysterious silence, and were withal the most melancholy party of pleasure he had ever witnessed. Nothing interrupted the stillness of the scene but the noise of the balls, which, whenever they were rolled, echoed along the mountains like rumbling peals of thunder. Okay, so this is like a game of lawn bowling. Only when the old men release the balls, thunder reacts to their movements. By degrees, Rip's awe and apprehension subsided. Even when he ventured, when no eye was fixed upon him, to taste the beverage, which he had found had much the flavor of excellent Hollands, he was naturally a thirsty soul and was soon tempted to repeat the draught. One taste provoked another, and he reiterated his trips to the flagon so often that at length his senses were overpowered, his eyes swam in his head gradually declined, and he fell into a deep sleep. In this, Rip drank away his productive years, which in some sense was what he had been doing all his life. Once he awakes, how do we know a great deal of time has passed? Well, we get details in the passage that follows. He looked around for his gun, but in place of the clean, well-oiled fowling piece, and here maybe I should point out that a fowling piece is a rifle designed to shoot fowl or birds. He found an old firelock lying by him, the barrel encrusted with rust, the lock falling off, and the stock worm-eaten. He now suspected that the grave roisterers of the mountain had put a trick upon him, and having dosed him with liquor, had robbed him of his gun. Wolf, too, had disappeared, but he might have strayed away after a squirrel or a partridge. And now comes the story's main point. Along with us readers, Rip is going to experience his town before and after the American Revolution, as though the transformation happened overnight, so that he, or rather we, can decide which was the better world and what were the actual ongoing social costs to freedom and independence. How has this drowsy town changed after the revolution? The village is larger, more prosperous. In ways, the Dame Van Winkles of the world have won out. People have traded social time for more work to give them more money. And when Rip arrives at the pub, does he find people enjoying themselves and chatting? Just the opposite. They are now debating what laws to enact. In this town, like many towns after the revolution, citizens were expected to work on their farms or hold jobs during the day, and then also participate without pay in the new government at night or on weekends. None of these government positions was compensated, so regular work during the day and often civic work at night. Also, in this world, there's now added risk. Before the revolution, if crops failed, the British government would make sure that no one starved. But now, with independence, these new countrymen need to arrange contingency plans for possible future trouble. There's an increase in luxury, but a decrease in leisure. There's an increase in independence, but a decrease in social enjoyment, as described in the following section. The very village was altered. It was larger and more populous. There were rows of houses which he had never seen before, and those which had been his familiar haunts had disappeared. Strange names were over the doors, strange faces at the windows. Everything was strange. The very character of the people seemed changed. A fellow was haranguing vehemently about rights of citizens, elections, members of Congress, liberty, and other words, which were a perfect Babylonian jargon. When Rip returns at the end of the tale, he finds a metamorphized community. It's no longer even the same country. In this new country, his uncompetitive cooperative spirit, his predisposition to idleness, his inclination to imaginative indulgences are badly out of place. Also out of place, his love for social enjoyment, endless community time with neighbors and children, and minimal worry about the future. In this, ultimately, the story isn't so much a narrative about Rip as it is a narrative that entices readers, and I mean readers back in 1819, into a reconsideration as to the lasting effects of the American Revolution, much as they might after reading an argumentative essay. And this story, the 1760s, are juxtaposed up against the 1780s in such a way readers can see the sharp contrast between the world before and after the revolution. The story is then asking, in which world would you, O readers, like to live? The world before the revolution with its focus on social enjoyments and a lower level of anxiety, or the world after the revolution with its focus on self-rule, independence, and the worldly comforts that come from a greater focus on work? And the story also seems to be suggesting that, at least in the view of its author, the revolution came with many benefits, but also with significant social costs, which were mainly in the form of an increased work burden and less social time for people to enjoy.